Hello and welcome to the episode 2 of What a Fab Day. I'm your host, Simon Mas. Yesterday, we saw the band having their audition at Decca Records in one of the key moments of their early career. Today, we will see the Fabs starting one of their last projects. But let's start with earlier entries in the band's history. On the 2nd of January 1963, the Beatles' early morning flight from London to Edinburgh was forced to land in Aberdeen due to the awful weather conditions. Since this was decided at last minute and mobile phones were yet to be invented, the four were left alone in Aberdeen without a chance to let their roadie, Neil Aspinall, who was duly waiting for them in Edinburgh with the band's van. By the time the situation became clear, there was little more to do than cancelling tonight's engagement. There was no chance that Aspinall could navigate the ice and snow-covered Scottish roads to Aberdeen and bring the lads on time to the Longmoor Hall in Keet, Banffshire. And so, the first of the 5 dates of the Beatles' 1963 Scottish tour never took place. Rather than spending the night in Aberdeen, John Lennon decided to fly to Liverpool and to spend the night there, regrouping with the rest of the band on the following day. Also today, but in 1964, the Beatles were featured in the 8th night of the Beatles Christmas Special variety show production at the Astoria Cinema in London. As usual, the first act on stage was the Baron Knights and Duke de Mond. Then, Tommy Quickly, and then the Foremost, had their quick sets, followed by Billy J. Kramer and the Dakotas for the closing of the first half of the two daily shows. After the interval, more Baron Knights and Duke de Mond, Cilla Black and Rolf Harris preceded the Beatles' conclusion with a 25-minute performance of Roll Over Beethoven, All of My Loving, This Boy, I Wanna Be Your Man, She Loves You, Till There Was You, I Want to Hold Your Hand, Money, That's What I Want, and Twist and Shout. On the 2nd of January 1965, the Beatles were featured in the 8th night of the Another Beatles Christmas Show variety show production at the Hammersmith Odeon Cinema in London. As usual, there were two houses today to accommodate for the ticket requests and, as usual, the Beatles appeared on stage to close each, after Freddie and the Dreamers, Sounds Incorporated, Elkie Brooks, The Yardbirds, Michael Haslam, The Mike Cotton Sound, and Ray Fell. Their 11-song set included Twist and Shout, I'm a Loser, Babies in Black, Everybody's Trying to Be My Baby, Can't Buy Me Love, Honey Don't, I Feel Fine, She's a Woman, A Hard Day's Night, Rock and Roll Music, and Long Tall Sally. The Fabs also appeared during the previous part of the shows for the sketches with Freddie Garrity of Freddie and the Dreamers and show compere Jimmy Savile. On this date in 1967, between 2:30 and 4 p.m, George Martin and Jeff Emerick copied the final mixes of When I'm 64 and Strawberry Fields Forever. The copies were made for Capitol Records, the Beatles' US label. None of the Fab Four were present. For the last entry in today's episode, we'll move forward to the 2nd of January 1969. It was on this date that the Beatles' most stressful project started, Get Back, an attempt to have the band getting back to its roots of live performances. The idea, as usual in the last phase of the band's career, was Paul McCartney's. He felt that by having a TV special featuring the band performing live in front of a real audience for the first time since April 1966, much of the bickering and ill feelings that had plagued the White Album sessions would melt away. But the timing was wrong. Not only the four were still exhausted after the long sessions for their 1968 album, but the project met resistance from everyone but McCartney. Ringo Starr had to start filming for the Magic Christian movie in February and was concerned about any long-term engagement with the band. George Harrison didn't want to hear about a return to live performances, and by this time had started to resent Paul's bossiness, verging on the dictatorial at times, and perfectionism in the studio. John Lennon, by his own admission, didn't give a shit. In John S. Wenner's book, Lennon Remembers, John makes clear that he didn't fancy playing live as well, but most importantly, he was almost constantly under the effect of heroin, to which he had become addicted at the time. After some discussion, in the second half of December 1968, Paul prevailed. The band would decide on the material, rehearse it, and then have the concert. All filmed to produce the TV special and a short half-hour documentary about the rehearsals. The production team included Michael Lindsay Hogg for the filming direction. He had already collaborated with the band for the clips of Paperback Writer, Rain, Hey Jude and Revolution. Tony Richman as director of photography and Glyn Jones as sound engineer. Jones was to be the sound troubleshooter, making sure that everything worked, a role normally given to a producer, but he was never given the title. Despite the green light given to the Get Back project, many questions remained unanswered. What kind of material should the band perform? Was it to be a concert of new compositions, or would the band cover some oldies as well? Original compositions or covers? When would the rehearsals have to be completed for? When would the concert take place and where? Regardless, the filming started today at 9:30 a.m. at the Twickenham Film Studios with Mal Evans and his assistant Kevin Harrington putting together the Beatles material on the studio's big sound stage. John Lennon, with Yoko Ono, George Harrison and Ringo Starr arrived at around the agreed start time of 11 a.m., while Paul McCartney, blaming public transports for his delay, only showed up at 12:30 p.m. They recorded 15 takes of Don't Let Me Down, 2 takes of Harrison's All Things Must Pass, the song will end up on his first solo album with the same name, 1 take of Dig a Pony, 2 takes of Let It Down, another Harrison original to be released on All Things Must Pass, 1 take each of Chuck Berry's Brown-Eyed Handsome Man, Lennon's A Case of the Blues, unreleased, Child of Nature, later released on Imagine, with different lyrics as Jealous Guy, and Revolution, and of Bob Dylan's I Shall Be Released, 5 takes of Sun King, 1 take of Buddy Holly's Mailman Bring Me No More Blues, and Jackie Lomax's Speak to Me, 20 takes of I've Got a Feeling, initially lacking Paul's contribution and still heavily based on John's 1968 demo Everybody Had a Hard Year, 1 take each of Bob Dylan's The Mighty Quinn and of Buddy Holly's Well Alright, 9 takes of Two of Us, 1 take of Lennon's Everybody Got a Song, and 1 take each for group jams called The Teacher Was a Looking, We're Going Home, and It's Good to See the Folks Back Home. This last one was led by Paul McCartney. The first day highlighted several more issues at hand, apart from those already touched upon. John's relatively dry spell as a songwriter, some of his material dated back to the early part of 1968, Paul not wanting to listen to the others' complaints about the cameras always on and the bad vibes of the soundstage, the uncertainty about the future of the Get Back project, today's discussion during the rehearsal seemed to indicate that there was a growing consensus about having the concert at the Twickenham Studios in front of an invited audience, the general lack of interest in George's songs, and the possibility of adding other musicians to the mix. Today, the band spoke at length about inviting a keyboard player with Nicky Hopkins' name mentioned. In the next 2 weeks, the Beatles maintained a Monday to Friday working schedule, starting between 11 a.m. and 1 p.m. While this was made to accommodate the necessities of the filming crew, it was much earlier than the band's usual late afternoon to early evening start. During the next 2 weeks, the four rehearsed an incredible number of songs, ranging from nursery rhymes to rock and roll standards, from Beatles oldies to new songs, some of which will end up being released during their respective solo careers, from impromptu tunes to radio oldies, passing through some long and unshaped jams, the best of which ended up in the Let It Be film, but that were mostly forgettable. Some of the songs were rehearsed in full, some in an abbreviated version, some were just tried out for a line or two and then abandoned forever. Most of all, the playing was sloppy. The Beatles were out of tune, out of time, disheartened, and still full of resentment towards each other. To quote John Lennon again, "Paul had this idea we were going to look for perfection all the time. And of course, we're lazy f***ers and we've been playing for 20 years. We're grown men, we're not going to sit around rehearsing, I'm not anyway. And we couldn't get into it. And we put down a few tracks and nobody was in it at all. It was a dreadful, dreadful feeling in Twickenham studio and being filmed all the time. I just wanted them to go away and we'd be there 8 in the morning. You couldn't make music at 8 in the morning or 10 or whatever it was in a strange place with people filming you and colored lights." As if more factors were needed to mar this ill-fated project, it didn't help that the Twickenham studios were physically called and that the Beatles doubled as executive producers of the project. For the first time, they were paying everything out of their pockets. Much later, some declared that it wasn't all doom and gloom, and that sometimes, especially after the band moved the filming and the rehearsals at the Apple headquarters, as we will see in a later podcast, one could still see the sparkle that had ignited the greatest rock band of the 1960s. But despite this revisionist view of the whole affair, this was a million miles away from the Beatles that seemed to have a telepathic connection and that spoke as a band even when having solo interviews. None of the rehearsals at Twickenham were recorded on the multitrack machines that could be found in any studio of the time. These were supposed to be simple rehearsals, and the Beatles never intended to release this material on an album. Mark Lewisohn says that the recordings were made on a two-track, hence stereo, machine, while BeatlesBible.com states that the band used two Nagra reel-to-reel quarter-inch monotape machines, one for each camera, alternating between them to allow for tape change, each reel of tape only lasting for 16 minutes. While only minuscule fragments of the Twickenham audio were released in Let It Be, the sessions have been bootlegged extensively. It is a pity that the public can only access these sessions on bootlegs, and that the only Beatles sessions to be so well documented were these, at the nadir of their personal relationship with one another. And on that mournful note, I guess we have to conclude today's episode. Please remember to visit www.simonmas.com/support to find out ways in which you can support me and my music-related projects, including this very podcast. If you can't find the link in the description, you might simply want to tell your friends about What a Fab Day to invite them to listen to it. That's already enough. As usual, the description will also feature links to buy the sources I've used for this episode through Amazon, should you want to do so. These are Amazon affiliate links, and anything you buy will not cost you a penny more than it would if you don't follow the link. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation.
Simon Mas, music you love.